Op vier daagjes vliegen van de aarde ligt ons dichtstbijzijnde hemellichaam, de maan. Er is geen lucht en de temperatuursverschillen zijn dodelijk. Ruimteingenieur Greg Bennett wil op de maan gaan wonen en hij wil duizenden aardbewoners met zich meenemen. Een paar geluksvogels hebben al eens mogen genieten van de leukste attractie die de maan te bieden heeft, haar geringe zwaartekracht.
If you were to go to the moon 30 years from now, you would think that the moon has simply become the Hong Kong of the solar system. It's going to be the trading center of the solar system. It's easy to get to from anywhere. It's easy to get anywhere from the moon. So it will have become the front door to the entire universe. We've picked a favorite spot on the moon for where we think we would like to build the first lunar city. And we selected it for a whole lot of reasons. One of them is that we want to have a really beautiful Earth view with the Earth rising almost stationary in the sky, moving about in the sky over the lunar mountains. We want it to be recognizable, and that's a key point. Now, if you look at the moon as it rises, in the northern hemisphere, right at the top, there's a little spot called Mare Crisium. And right at the top of that little spot, there's a little place that we've sort of nicknamed Angus Bay. And we think right there would probably be one of the best places we could put our moon base. There's really no great technical challenge to be faced. I mean, there's a lot of engineering to be done, but it's not anything that requires inventing new technologies. It's applying what we already know.
3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff. Liftoff.
Maar wat weten we nu eigenlijk over de maan? De Apollo-astronauten hebben bijna 400 kilo maangesteente mee naar huis gebracht.
Let's see if I can't crack the corner and get that contact. See if I can't get her.
Look at the boulders out there.
Uit de analyse van dat gesteente is gebleken dat de maan heel wat nuttige mineralen herbergt, zoals silicium, magnesium, aluminium en titanium. Er zijn dus misschien wel genoeg grondstoffen om een beschaving op te bouwen. Maar sinds Apollo 17 het in 1972 voor bekeken hield, zijn er geen aardse bezoekers meer op de maan geweest. 30 jaar lang zag het er naar uit dat dit het laatste feestje van onze soort in de ruimte was geweest. Deze stoere ontdekkingsreizigers hebben hun machtige vondst nooit kunnen ontginnen. In januari 1998 is een nieuw ruimtetijdperk aangebroken. Met deze raket ging het geesteskind van Dr. Alan Binder de ruimte in. Een laagtechnologisch onbemand toestel met de naam Lunar Prospector. De Lunar Prospector gaat niet naar de maan zelf, maar komt in een baan rond de maan. De expeditie kost hoogstens 2,5 miljard frank, de helft van een jumbojet en een fractie van wat de maanreis tot nu toe moest kosten. Binder wou de geldende ideeën over de ontginning van de maan op hun kop zetten. En net als alle revolutionairen moest hij klein beginnen. De Lunar Prospector was nog geen 3 maanden vertrokken of de wetenschap stond al op haar kop. Op grond van de Apollo-monsters dacht iedereen dat de maan kurkdroog was. Maar diep in de kraters aan de polen van de maan ontdekte de Prospector waterstof, waarschijnlijk in de vorm van bevroren water. Alan Binder.
Clearly the presence of water ice that we have detected is of fundamental importance because we no longer have to go to the moon with all our fuel. We can use this lunar water, break it down to hydrogen and oxygen, and use it as fuel. We can also use the water for life support. So rather than take, you know, hundreds of tons of water or fuel to the moon, we've got it. This really will make lunar exploration, lunar colonization, you know, vastly less expensive than it would otherwise.
Dankzij de prospector wordt de maan nu niet meer beschouwd als een kale broksteen, maar als een ongerept gebied dat rijp is voor ontginning. Ruimtevaartdeskundigen van alle slag laten hun fantasie nu de vrije loop en dragen fabelachtige visioenen uit over wat we allemaal met de maan gaan doen. Het koloniseren van de maan mag dan wel goedkoper zijn geworden. Het kost nog altijd vele tientallen miljarden. En wie gaat dat allemaal betalen? Jim Benson is een succesvol zakenman. Hij denkt dat de maan zal worden ontgonnen door het bedrijfsleven in plaats van de overheid.
Space is too expensive to do as a taxpayer-supported program. We need to find ways to make space pay, and then we can do anything that makes a profit. We can go to space and do all those things. But if space doesn't pay, we just can't go to stay.
Er zijn al bedrijven die tientallen miljoenen bij elkaar hebben gekregen met de belofte dat er op de maan fortuinen te rapen vallen. Eén zo'n maanontginningsbedrijf is Benson's Space Dev.
When I think about lunar colonies, I think of all the business opportunities, providing the energy, providing the transportation, providing the communications, step by step building up to the point where we can have settlements and colonies. If Space Dev can supply a lot of those infrastructure needs, we're going to be a very big company. Space is infinite. The resources are infinite. The opportunities are infinite.
Dadelijk krijgt de maan misschien wel de krachtigste cocktail geserveerd die de aarde te bieden heeft. Wetenschap in combinatie met particulier initiatief. Na 3 miljard jaar geologische stilstand mag deze pokdalige woestenij zich eindelijk verheugen in de zegeningen van de vooruitgang. Benson weet gewoon dat de wereld binnenkort overspoeld zal worden door een ware maankoorts. Dus bouwt hij zijn eigen ruimtecentrum in het zuiden van Californië.
Well, this is our main conference room, and we'll be using this for planning our strategy, our different missions, talking to potential investors. This is the this will be the mission control center with 4 or 5 PCs and monitor screens along here. We're building 3 clean rooms that will go back through here, and visitors will be able to come in and look at us building on maybe up to 3 different spacecraft simultaneously. The first company that flies a highly profitable and publicly visible mission beyond Earth is going to change people's consciousness about space. They'll realize that space is a place. It's not a government program. Space is available to everyone. Public access to space. But we've got to have a visible, commercial, private, successful mission first. Then all hell's going to break loose.
Eerst komt er een voorhoede van intelligente machines, zoals de robot Nomad.
Nomad is a planetary rover prototype. It is a four-wheel vehicle that uses laser and stereo cameras to navigate autonomously on natural terrain.
Zelfstandig zijn weg vinden betekent dat er geen mens meer aan te pas komt. De Nomad neemt zijn eigen beslissingen en kan dus gebieden verkennen waar de mens niet kan overleven. Als de Nomad zijn wielen intrekt, is hij nog maar 1,5 meter breed, zodat hij in het laadruim past van een doorsnee ruimteraket. Als ze 800 miljoen frank bij elkaar kunnen krijgen, maken de ontwerpers van de Nomad zich sterk dat hun geesteskind als eerstvolgende vorm van intelligentie op de maan zal landen. Dr. Whitaker.
Already, Nomad has capabilities to see, to safeguard, to communicate. It is a veteran of hundreds of kilometers of travel in space analogous terrain here on Earth. And it is a continuing, persistent evolution of the technologies and the operations and the ideas that are essential to carry us from Earth to back to the moon.
En als hij dan goed en wel op de maan is, kan de Nomad het oppervlak afzoeken naar de beste locatie voor een maanbasis.
Derivatives of the Nomad design will be roaming on the lunar surface, looking for materials to extract, try to perform scientific investigations, and prototype this notion of robotic colonization of an extraterrestrial surface. We all have a very intimate relationship with this robot. We are the people that conceived it, designed it, built it. When Nomad is on the moon, it will be as if one part of ourselves is actually operating up there.
Als de Nomad een goed plekje gevonden heeft, kunnen we een tweede lichting robots op pad sturen met meer mogelijkheden. Kuma Ramohalli is een maanfanaat en vader van een robot die veel meer kan dan rondkijken.
The moon will be teeming with intelligent robots during the next 30 years. This particular one is called the Common Lunar Lander. It comes from a craft launched from the Earth, possibly assembled in space as we are traveling. And lands softly on the moon like that. And then the robotic arm picks up the soil from the moon, very much like the lunar simulant dust that we have here, puts it in the oven here. The solar collector collects the sunlight, focuses here, and points it to the soil, and we make any material that we want, bricks, briquettes, tiles like this one, for example. We have made this one from the lunar soil. And if you make bricks and beams of certain particular shapes and sizes, you can assemble them much like we build homes on this Earth.
Volgens Ramohalli kunnen we bouwmaterialen maken van maanstof. En daarmee zouden we de kostprijs van een maanbasis met vele miljarden naar beneden kunnen halen. Zonder zijn bouwmachine zouden bouwmaterialen van de aarde moeten komen. En dat zou een miljard frank per ton kosten. Ramohalli heeft uitgerekend dat één robot in 6 maanden 12 hutjes in elkaar kan zetten. Daar kunnen dan de eerste pioniers in wonen. Maar hoe zou ons leven op de maan eruit zien? Astronauten hebben het al heel lang kunnen volhouden in ruimtestations, maar daar zaten ze in een baan om de aarde en konden ze nog bevoorraad worden. Eten naar de maan laten overvliegen zou een dure grap worden, dus maanpioniers zullen hun eigen boontjes moeten doppen. Het Life Support Department van de NASA heeft onlangs uitgeprobeerd hoe het moet zijn om op een zelfstandige maanbasis te leven. In 1997 hebben 4 vrijwilligers zich 90 dagen lang laten opsluiten in een stalen blik van 7 meter bij 7 in de wandeling De Kamer genoemd. Gedurende de volle 90 dagen konden wetenschappers van buitenaf met videoapparatuur volgen wat er in de kamer gebeurde en hoe de wetenschappelijke experimenten daar verliepen. Een mens neemt per jaar ongeveer 900 kilo eten tot zich. Als de toekomstige pioniers hun verblijf op de maan willen overleven, zullen ze op zijn minst een deel daarvan zelf moeten verbouwen.
The experiments we've got going on in this chamber are looking at how we can use plants. Plants obviously will provide us with food for our space crews on the surface of the moon. This is a lunar simulant that we're looking at, which is essentially very, very similar to what we find on the surface of the moon. It's a high titanium basalt, and it does well in growing plants. Of course, what we'd have to do on the moon, since there is no atmosphere, we'd have to bring it inside some habitation chamber, some plant growth area, but we should be able to use it pretty much as is. Now, this is wheat, and these particular varieties of wheat are what we call super dwarf varieties that have been bred specifically for use in these plant production systems for space applications. This variety, as you can see, gets very, very short, but it's high yielding and does well under very high production conditions. We provide high light to this crop, and we provide 24 hours of light to this crop. Now, other crops that we're looking at besides wheat and sweet potatoes are white potatoes, soybeans, rice, and tomatoes, and a whole host of lesser quantities of crops, herbs, or some of the herbs and spices as well. Inside this chamber, we have a crop of sweet potatoes growing. This crop was planted 30 days ago and is growing hydroponically. Hydroponic production of plants is growing plants just in nutrient solution. There's no soil. The reason we like to do that is that we can very precisely control the amount of nutrients that they get, and we also then can grow the plants in a much faster way.
Nigel Peckham, een van de proefpersonen.
We did evaluate a diet that we would potentially use on the lunar surface, made up of about 15 different crops. I'm not sure if taste-wise you'd want to do that for 3, 4, 5 years or longer. Certainly in our first missions to the moon, we're going to be forced to grow only those type of crops. But I think as we go on in exploration, we may want to look more at animals, for example. Maybe even starting out as lowly as fish and working our way up from there.
I have 1270 in B1.
1270 B1.
While I'm here, let me do the other one again.
Bij fotosynthese geven planten zuurstof af die mensen kunnen inademen en water dat ze kunnen opdrinken. Planten kunnen dus menselijk leven ondersteunen op een maan waar geen lucht is en geen water vloeit. De eerste pioniers zullen het er zo een paar maanden kunnen uitzingen. Sterker nog, hele generaties kolonisten zullen er kunnen leven. In de kamer heeft de NASA een ecosysteem uitgetest dat voor onbepaalde tijd in staat is menselijk leven te ondersteunen en dat klein genoeg is om in een maanbasis te passen.
During our 90-day test, we looked at combinations of biological approaches and physical, chemical, machinery, if you will, approaches to recycling air and water. Nature has done an excellent job of devising methods for providing life support to us on Earth, so there's no reason why we shouldn't adapt those same methodologies for use in space as well, and that's exactly what we're doing.
Intensieve recycling is niet voor doetjes. Dit drinkwater is van urine gemaakt.
Well, let me take you on a quick tour of the bathroom while we're here.
Right here is what remains of the urinal hose.
The men urinated directly into the measuring cylinder to measure it. The women urinated into a beaker and then transferred that into a measuring cylinder. So this was really just the recipient of the urine. The solid waste was actually collected and logged in the chamber, sent out of the chamber, and incinerated outside, with the product gases of which is mainly carbon dioxide. The plants feeding on that carbon dioxide then provided oxygen back to us, and also food in the form of the grain.
So the grain came back in here, we milled it into flour, made wheat. So you can see that we're eventually getting to this recycling program, the ultimate in recycling.
Op basis van de ervaringen van de vier vrijwilligers heeft de NASA geschat hoeveel planten kolonisten minimaal nodig hebben om op de maan te kunnen overleven.
Our estimates for the plant area, the growing area that we require for one human to provide food on an ongoing, continuous basis is about 30 square meters. Now, in terms of the plant's ability to consume carbon dioxide and to produce oxygen, we only need about 10 square meters of that of growing area for one person on an ongoing, continuous basis.
De meeste maangewassen zullen in kleine kassen worden gekweekt om ze sneller te laten groeien. Maar L. Holland, de psycholoog van de kamer, merkte dat het nuttig is overal planten neer te zetten. Een toefje groen doet wonderen.
Closing that hatch for the last time, slamming it down and closing that hatch has a psychological effect, and it's a sense of finality that, yes, this is going to be my world, there's no going back. And I think for a lunar colony, it'll be the same thing. Anytime you're looking at people in long-duration confined environments, you must start thinking about normalizing their life. Because these are normal, high-achieving people in a very abnormal living situation because they're cut off from their larger social milieu. So anything you can do to normalize that life is important, which includes the use of plants not only for physicochemical regeneration, but also for the psychological regeneration that occurs with contact with plants. Diversity of life forms is very important. If we could have pets on a lunar colony, if they weren't too distracting or too disruptive, that would be even better. So I think it's important to allow people a wide array of ways to recharge their psychic batteries, so to speak, their emotional batteries. And exposure to plants, keeping plants, is one part of this.
There was definitely a therapeutic aspect of having the few lettuce plants that we had in here growing hydroponically. We took them from seedlings all the way up to full-grown lettuce plants. And apart from the length of our hair, those were about the only things that changed in this chamber. Nothing else really changed. So tending the lettuce plants was very important. Thinning them became quite a difficult decision, which ones to take out and let go, and the other ones take all the way on to maturity.
We have techniques to deal with almost all the contingencies that we've looked at. We can do them more elegantly with lower amounts of consumables, for example, lower power requirements. We can make smaller pieces of hardware that weigh less, take up less volume, and so on. But really, there are no technological showstoppers from putting in place on the surface of the moon a life support system which will work and which will work well.
We hebben de techniek om een maanbasis tot wasdom te brengen, maar hoe krijg je mensen zo gek om er in grote getalen te komen wonen? Het antwoord ligt niet op de maan, maar op onze oude, vertrouwde aarde. De menselijke beschaving is een gevaar voor de aarde. En over 30 jaar zijn we nog eens met 2 keer zoveel. Deskundigen voorspellen een energietekort en roepen de rijkere landen op iets aan hun tomeloze verspilzucht te doen. Er is één wetenschapper uit Texas die de toekomst anders ziet. Volgens hem kan iedereen leven als een Amerikaan, zolang hij er maar geen aardse energiebronnen voor gebruikt. Zijn naam is David Criswell.
Solar power is what you is your ultimate resource in this solar system for power. And fortunately, it's an enormous power source, the trillions of times or billions of times more than we actually need here on Earth. And so the challenge is to just divert a tiny little bit of it efficiently down here to the Earth in such a way that it doesn't disrupt the environment.
Maar op aarde laat de zon het maar al te vaak afweten. David Criswell heeft daarom zijn fantasie aan het werk gezet en is voor de dag gekomen met een zonnecentrale op de maan.
The lunar solar power system is a way to provide solar electric energy on Earth. But rather than capturing the sunlight on Earth, you capture it on the moon. The moon is exposed continuously to sunlight in a very dependable way because it has no atmosphere. On the moon, you can use photocells in very thin film form to take sunlight, change it to electricity, and then another set of solid-state electronics can change that electric power into microwaves, and then the microwaves would deliver the power in the form of beams back down to Earth.
Willen we de aarde van alle energie voorzien die we nodig hebben zonder aardse brandstof te verbruiken, dan moeten we de maan omtoveren tot één grote energiecentrale. Daarvoor moeten we hele stukken van de maan bedekken met zonnepanelen die we van maanstof maken. Criswell schat dat het 30 jaar en tientallen biljoenen frank zal kosten om een netwerk van zonnepanelen op de maan te zetten. Daarvoor zijn niet alleen robots, maar ook minstens 5000 mensen nodig. En als zo'n industriële maanbasis zich net zo ontwikkelt als een menselijke kolonie op aarde, zal ze groeien en zich diversifiëren.
Once you have a source of wealth on the moon, it'll become like a mining town in Colorado back in the last century. People will find reasons to be there, most of which have absolutely nothing to do with the primary activity. One of the rewards for me would be to be buried on the moon.
Volgens sommige maanfanaten zal de maan zoveel aantrekkingskracht op de mensen uitoefenen dat er een spectaculaire en mondaine stad zal verrijzen. Die stad zal niet in het teken staan van arbeid, maar van vrije tijd. Een van de aanhangers van deze theorie is de ruimte-econoom Patrick Collins.
As economic growth continues, more and more of the work we do is to do with what people want, what customers want, not what they need anymore. And one of the things they want is tourism. And frankly, the world is getting smaller and smaller now. You know, there's nowhere you can go that's new. There's nowhere you can go where you're out of reach of a mobile phone. So space is the next frontier for tourism. The first people to go there are going to be adventurers, people for whom it's really their life's ambition to go to the moon. And then there's going to be, you know, the rich will go once it's really comfortable and safe. And I guess if you go there in 100 years, it'll be pretty much like Vegas.
Ook al ligt Las Vegas midden in een onbarmhartige woestijn, het is de snelst groeiende stad in de Verenigde Staten. Dat komt doordat Las Vegas draait rond de grootste economische sector ter wereld, toerisme. Er staan hier hotels die meer dan 50 miljard frank hebben gekost. Net zoveel als een kleine basis op de maan.
A lot of money is spent on tourism on Earth. More people spend money on vacations than we do on science by far. Everybody likes to imagine themselves being on another planet, exploring the solar system. And this is now getting to the point where it will happen and can happen. Now that prospectors discovered water, we can have a golf course and a swimming pool.
Omdat er veel minder zwaartekracht is op de maan, zullen mensen zich lichter voelen en zullen ze wonderen kunnen verrichten waar ze op aarde nog niet van zouden dromen.
Running is going to be different when you're on the moon because you're not going to have as much traction between your feet and the ground. So it'll take you longer to get started. You'll start skidding, or just start skidding your feet like a cartoon character. In fact, if you wanted to, you could actually run across the swimming pool walking on water.
The ceilings in the rooms are going to have to be a good deal higher because in the 1/6 gravity on the moon, when you walk, you kind of bounce up and down. So people who aren't used to that, they're just going to bang their heads like this.
See, the average person probably could jump maybe a foot in the air on Earth. In 1/6 gravity, you'd be able to jump about your own height. That could change the way we design staircases. You'll be able to throw a ball much, much farther. I don't know if we'll have enough room for a golf course, but you could imagine what it would be like to drive off the tee with 2,400 yards.
In low gravity, you know, water's going to fall very, very, very slowly like this from the fountain. And so some kind of interesting rotating water shape would be a, you know, really great, totally unique thing that you cannot do on Earth.
I think the moon is going to be a wonderful place for old folks. One of the biggest medical disasters that can hit an elderly person is to fall down and get a hip fracture. If you fall down on the moon, you don't get hurt. You could fall down on a concrete surface and it would be just like landing on pillows.
In 1/6 gravity, humans can fly like birds. So from here, well, if this was the outside view, the other side of the apartment might be into a dome from the top of the hotel down to the ground. So you could go out onto the balcony, flap your wings, and just fly off.
Sommige toeristen zullen de stad uit willen vliegen om de omgeving te verkennen.
To me, the moon is an extremely beautiful place. I must admit, I like deserts. I like barren things on the earth. I enjoy that kind of environment. When you go, if you look at the Apollo 11 landing site, which of course chosen because it was flat, it may be uninteresting to most people. I think it's beautiful, and you may recall the astronauts themselves said that it had a certain type of beauty to it.
Columbia, this is Houston reading you loud and clear, over.
Yeah, reading you loud and clear, how's it going?
Oh, it's beautiful, Mike, it really is.
But if you go, for example, to the Apollo 15 landing site, you've got a mountain behind you which is 5 kilometers high. You've got a valley in front of you which is a kilometer across and 300 meters deep. It's a mini Grand Canyon, if you will, and it's just spectacular. I think there are many, many areas on the moon which someday will be national parks.
Ruimtetoerisme is nu al een sector waar miljoenen dollars in opgaan. Daarom heeft Greg Bennett na 20 jaar zijn baan bij de NASA vaarwel gezegd. In plaats van astronauten op te leiden, werkt hij nu voor een bedrijf dat hotels in de ruimte gaat opzetten. Zijn nieuwe werkgever zit in Las Vegas. Daar leert hij nu de fijnere kneepjes van het hotelwezen.
These people know how to make a fun place, right? Maybe we can talk them into building the Luna City Hotel. Well, the materials they use here remind me a lot of what it'll be like on the moon. Everything is built of stone. You don't need to get these beautiful floors just by polishing the rock. You need a lot of room. You don't want to feel claustrophobic when you build a place like this. For one thing, the ceiling is high enough. So if you start bouncing on the moon in 1/6 gravity, leaping your own height into the sky, at least you won't bump your head. You know that dry atmosphere that you get on an airplane? Well, you have to avoid that. So we'll probably have lots of fountains, lots of water courses everywhere, waterfalls. One day we will be standing in a space just like this, with maybe a lot more greenery, right on the surface of the moon itself, you know, and we'll be standing on floors made out of the actual rock of the moon.
Een van de ideetjes is een hotel met een glazen koepel van een kilometer doorsnee. Zoiets kost natuurlijk wel een paar miljard, maar er kunnen duizenden toeristen in die met plezier meer dan 60.000 frank voor een nacht zullen betalen.
Within less than 10 years now we'll have short trips to space. Within less than 20 years we'll have short trips to hotels in orbit.
Yes.
And then in less than 30 years we're going to have hotels on the moon.
If we get this evolution going and move at the same pace that we did, or even half the pace that we did during the Apollo era, 30 years from now, I can imagine tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people living on the moon. Once you start building it, you know, it can expand, and you can have people not only going for a year, but you can go and have them stay forever and have children and have their children have children, just as our forefathers, you know, 200 years ago started coming to this continent, and look at how many people are here now. This is a dream of humanity.
Vanop de maan zou de kolonisatie van de rest van het zonnestelsel kunnen beginnen.
The moon is quite important for the long-term continued human exploration of the solar system, because it's filled with all the important things that humans need to live and work and prosper in space.
We weten al dat maangesteente alle metalen bevat die de lucht- en ruimtevaartindustrie nodig heeft. Dr. Bennett.
You can use the magnesium, the aluminum, the titanium to build spacecraft to go to Mars, to Venus, to Jupiter, to the stars for all I know. To build those things, to transport them into space from the Earth's surface is very, very, very costly. From the moon it's quite inexpensive once we have that complex set up.
Omdat het zwaartekrachtveld van de maan zoveel zwakker is, kost een vlucht veel minder energie. Ruimteschepen kunnen van hieruit dus genoeg vaart maken om nieuwe horizonten te verkennen. To boldly go where nobody has been before.
I think by the 60th anniversary of the Apollo program, the moon will be occupied by many thousands of people, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. It will be the grand central station, if you will, to the rest of the solar system. And it will be the primary place for humanity off Earth. It'll be our first, not just outpost, but the first place that we really live. I think there'll be children born there, and some of them will be a few years old by that time. So, and that'll be just the start of the process. And so it will be the real stepping stone for humanity on beyond its own limits.
We're starting into a brand new era, a brand new millennium, and I think we can accomplish anything that our imaginations allow us and that the technology is available for. And it's so hard to predict what can be possible, but why not have orbiting businesses and orbiting hotels leading to human settlements on the moon and scientific outposts and even hotels on the moon and Mars eventually. All of that's possible and will happen. The question is when.